earlier I mentioned sampling, and I asked you whether that sounded useful, and you said it was. So let's do a little exercise. Why is that a useful thing? Why is it a good idea to be able to sample from a distribution?
Well, because it's one of the two things that distributions are for.
What does that mean?
Well, so why do you have a distribution? A distribution is so that given some value, you can tell me what's the probability of me seeing that value, which is kind of what it looks like when you have the probability function. But also, if you have a nice distribution, you can generate values according to that distribution.
Okay. That's a little bit circular in the sense that it didn't tell me why it was useful to generate them other than it's one of the things you can do.
Well, you didn't ask me to actually make sense. But, I mean, this is the thing that you use distributions for. Now, why would you want to do that?
Yeah.
So if a distribution represents kind of a process, it would be nice if I could duplicate that process, right? So I would have to be able to generate values in the right way, consistent mm-hmm. with the distribution, in order to generate that process. So it's like flipping a coin. I want to flip a coin. And find out whether I'm going to get heads or tails. It would be nice if I could do that in a way that's consistent with whatever the underlying bias of the coin is.
Okay. So, yeah. So if this distribution represented something complex, we might, you know, for whatever reason, need to simulate that world and act according to those probabilities. So, yeah, that's a reasonable one. What else? What if I showed you this, if I took the distribution that we used for the lightning and thunder example,
mm-hmm.
And what if you wanted to get a handle on it? How could we use sampling from the distribution to give you some insight into how the storms work?
Okay, so let's see. So I've got this representation of the joint distribution, but it's just a representation of the joint distribution. If I want to ask a question like, well, what's the chance that it's, oh, let's say, storming outside if I've heard thunder? I could go through and you know, back compute the reverse of the conditional probability tables, and I can do things like that. Or I could just generate a bunch of samples where I had thunder, and I can just see how often storm was also true. Does that make sense?
It does, though. I'm not going to use the words that you just used to write that down.
Okay.
I'm going to call that approximate inference. So the basic idea is that you would like to do some inference. You'd like to figure out what might be true of the world in different situations. And instead of doing some complex probability calculation, you're just going to imagine a bunch of possible worlds and see how often is it the case that whatever it is that you want to figure out is true. So, yeah, that turns out to be a really good way to do it. In fact, sometimes I think that's a lot of what people are doing when we're making judgments in the world. We're just really, really good at this kind of sampling from past realities that are relevant. And we can make judgments based on that.
So how would you do that?
How would I do what?
How would you do this approximate inference?
We're going to get to that, but I wanted to.
Okay, cool.
But there's one or two other things about sampling that I wanted to mention.
Okay.
Another thing that I could imagine using this for is this notion of visualization, which maybe is. I mean this in a broader way than it sounds. Not necessarily to actually see what the distribution is like, but to kind of get a feel for it. So I bet if I was to run that, if I was to draw a bunch of samples from the Lightning Thunder set, you would have a better feel for how likely different things are. Just you as a person might get a sense of how these things work. So you could imagine in a medical domain, a doctor who's thinking about prescribing a particular kind of drug for a particular kind of person, if the information about drug interactions and so forth was represented as a big belief net, it might be hard to look at it and know anything. But if you use that to generate a bunch of artificial patients, you might start to get to feel for, oh, you know what, these kinds of people tend to react badly in these kinds of circumstances.
That's still a kind of approximate inference, right?
But yeah, but it's right. That's right. So this is kind of in the machine sense, and this is kind of in the human sense.
Okay, I like that. So let's see if I understand it. So the nice thing about the storm, the thunder, and the lightning example is it has pedagogical value because it's easy for a student to look at that and go, okay, I understand what's going on here. One, because there's only three nodes and two arrows, and the other is because we think we understand how storms, thunder, and lightning work, right?
Yep.
Or most people do. So that makes a lot of sense. Of course, the downside of it is we think we understand it, and so it's hard to see why you would need to do samples. I mean, there's just a couple of probability distributions, and we kind of know what it means. But in the real world, there are perhaps hundreds and hundreds of variables with complicated relationships and conditional independencies that aren't necessarily intuitive just by looking at the graph. And so picking one conditional probability table and looking at it isn't going to tell you much. But by sampling, I get real examples that are concrete that as a human being I can understand without having to, you know, really grok all the 25 different conditional probability tables. Does that sound right? Is that what you're trying to say?
That's exactly right. Thanks.
Okay.
I want to draw your attention to this word here for a moment, this notion of approximate inference. Now, generally, we don't like approximations when we can do things exactly. So why are we not doing things exactly?
Because it's hard?
It's hard. That's exactly right. So or even if it weren't hard, it may be in some cases faster. So I'm not going to do it now, but I'd be happy if there's a groundswell of support amongst the students to I can go through the argument as to why this inference is hard. There's a nice little reduction to problems and NP-complete problems like satisfiability. But it turns out roughly that if you could do inference exactly on any belief net that you want, then you could solve very, very hard problems efficiently using that idea. So it's cute, but it kind of takes us a little bit off our path, so I'm not going to get into that.
Okay, so sampling is useful, Michael, which I always suspected in my heart. And now we've got some good arguments for why it actually is.